We walked back via Kelvin Bridge. This was the mid-90s, so my team, Partick Thistle, were on the other, on another slide down the leagues. With red and yellow scarf up over my mouth, I practiced my griping and grumbling about the game. I knew what it took to be a real fan. Like the man in the seats behind us who said, "I've seen enough of this," after 10 minutes, and then stayed to join in with the booze at the end. My dad, walking beside me, paused by the turn-off to a table line. I carried on for a step or two, dragging at his hand. This was another part of our Saturday routine. Dad wanting to stop at every second-hand bookshop and record store on the way home, and me fidget-filled, chiding at him to pass them by. I began negotiations. 10 pence a minute. A penny. 5 pence. 2. Fine, but I get to time it. He unbuckled his watch and handed it down to me. I started timing from the moment we left the main road. The shop was down a cobbled lane. The walls seemed to be made of books. Piles upon piles. There was no order to them, so searches needed to be carefully planned archaeological digs. Landslides were common. There were no Asterix comics or just William books, I checked. All the books seemed to have titles as complex and multi-layered as the stains upon their spines. My dad picked them up, flipped through 2 or 3 pages, then set them back down. After 11 minutes, I tapped at the watch in my hand. I'd made 22 pence. He held up 2 fingers, 2 more minutes. By the time we actually left, I'd made another 8 pence. Then I earned 18 pence in the record store, where my dad pulled the black discs from their sleeves, inspected their ridges, then slipped them back onto the shelf, and another 10 pence from the bookshop that had a cat curled on the counter. Tabby fur, against tarnished, mottled, hardback books. My dad was in debt to the tune of 58 pence by the time we made it home. I settled for a shiny, single 50 pence coin, and I promised that I could stay up for much of the day. 2 decades later, I'm in Brighton on a sunny Saturday. Partick Thistle are playing, but the best I can do is check the score on my mobile phone. We drink gin cocktails at a beachfront bar, me, my wife, and 2 friends. As clouds gather, we make our way up to the North Lane. By that time, the final whistle has blown in Glasgow. Partick Thistle win at home for the first time this season against Aberdeen. My dad is there, and so too, presumably, are the real fans who will mutter about bloody time and turn towards the exits. In the tight capillary streets off North Lane, I hold 2 fingers up to my wife in that direction. 2 minutes, then veer off into a bookshop. There are electronic security detectors at the door, but I don't think the pencil marks inside the covers of the book would set them off. I browse quickly, aware that the others are waiting. There's a book of short stories by Deborah Levy that I'd like, and a novel by John McGregor. Then I come across a book by Ronan Bennett. I pull this book off the shelf too. I have 3 now. Each has a pencil scribbled £3 inside, the pound sign looking like a reflection of the number. I only have £7 in change though, so I'm faced with a dilemma. This isn't the type of place that accepts cards. I don't know how many minutes pass before my wife comes to find me and turns my left wrist with gentle fingers until my watch is facing upwards. "The others are waiting," she says. "I have 3. "That's okay," she smiles, "you can have 3. "I don't have enough. Do you want some money?" I nod. For the rest of the evening, I sit with a brown paper parcel of books beside me. With the arrival of each new drink, I remind myself not to forget them. By the 5th or 6th, neurosis takes over and I borrow a pen from the barman so that I can scrawl my address on the package, just in case. On the train back home, I keep my arms crossed over them. We debate the Scottish referendum with a drunk from Hastings who tells me that I'd have to be certifiable to vote yes, but then confides that if he were Scottish, he would definitely vote for independence. I point out the contradiction, so he repeats his argument, the same words but louder. To give myself an excuse for ignoring him, I peel open my parcel and flip through the first few pages of each of my second-hand books. There's a coffee stain on the second page of the McGregor. When I get home, I will phone my dad. He will tell me about the match, and I will tell him about the books that I bought this afternoon that will cost 9 pence per minute.